Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for joining us for our second live stream event with Bruce Powers Medical Isotope Advisory Council. My name is James Cognac, and I'm the Executive Vice President for Corporate Affairs and Operational Services at Bruce Power. In our last session we held, we focused a lot on medical isotopes such as lutetium and molybdenum-99. And today we're going to have a significant focus on cobalt-60. For those of you that that may not be aware of what cobalt-60 is, how it is used, cobalt-60 is a medical isotope that is, frankly, I call it a Canadian isotope, even though an isotope can be in theory made anywhere. But it's an isotope that Canada leads the world in producing. And our panelists here today are going to talk first and foremost about the production of cobalt-60 from our reactors at Bruce Power and Pickering, the use of cobalt-60 in medical sterilization, in particular in the fight against COVID-19, the use of cobalt-60 in the treatment of cancer, and also the use of cobalt-60 in agricultural and other very interesting applications. Additionally, our president and CEO of Bruce Power, Mike Renchek, has also joined us, and he has some exciting news to share with people today by way of an update on the activities on site between Bruce Power and Nordion. I do want to start today's session with a safety message. Our number one value at Bruce Power is safety first. And you know, as we're thinking about the safety of our communities, oftentimes we've focused a lot, rightfully so, on the various measures that public health officials have recommended when it comes to preventing and limiting the spread of COVID-19. But the safety message I want to talk about today has to do with mental health. There was a recent statistic released this week here in the province of Ontario that the leading cause of gun deaths in Ontario over the last year has actually been from male suicides. And it really that's a really stark reminder that we all need to be reminded of the importance of mental health, not only in our families, with our neighbors, in our communities, but the organizations that we work in. And while COVID-19 has been a significant physical health challenge, it's presented many economic challenges to our communities and society. All of those elements also have a mental health toll on people. And so the safety message today is really about looking out for fatigue, looking out for people who may be having challenging times from a mental health perspective, and using those supports, either the supports that are made available through the organizations in which we work, whether it's an employee and family assistance program, whether it's for youth, kids' help phones and kids' helplines, some of the resources that the Ontario government and the Canadian Mental Health Association have made available. All of these items are really important for us to keep as a top focus in our minds when we're thinking about our health and our safety. So let's look out for everybody's mental health and be very comfortable with encouraging people to be open about it and recognizing that mental health, it's not just one segment of the population or one group. It impacts everybody, and our mental health is as critical as our physical health. With that safety message in mind, I really want to welcome a number of individuals who are with us this morning. I mentioned Bruce Power's president and CEO, Mike Renchek. We have Susan Marshall joining us, who's the president and CEO of the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. I also want to welcome Dr. Myra Hogg from he's an assistant professor of radiation oncology at Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center in Toronto. Cynthia Scott Dupree, who's a professor and chair of the Crop Science Center at the University of Guelph, and University of Guelph, I'm a grad at University of Guelph, Cynthia. And so you're one of my favorite panelists today because you're from the University of Guelph. Richard Weens, he has a formal title of Director of Strategic Supply, but he's director of Find as Much Cobalt-60 as we can in the world and make it available. And Richard has been really critical to Bruce Power's partnership with Nordion dating back over a decade. While we talk often about Bruce Power and the work that we do with cobalt-60, we're only able to do that really through the leadership of Nordion. So I appreciate Richard joining us today. And also Michael Barrett, who's the president and CEO of the South Bruce Gray Regional Health Center. And you'll be hearing more from Michael later on. So really excited about the lineup today. Really excited that we have this medical isotope advisory panel. It really goes to show you just the depth of this in Canada's isotope community, Canada's nuclear industry, and what I would also call is Canada's cancer and disease fighting sector. So with that in mind, I'll pass it over to our first speaker today to really talk about some of the progress we've been making at Bruce Power, share with us some really exciting news and his broader perspective on this opportunity, what it means for not only Bruce Power, but Canada and beyond. So without further ado, I'll pass it over to you, Mike. Can you guys hear Mike?
The depth that we have here in Ontario and in Canada in terms of medical isotopes and our ability to fight cancer as well as produce isotopes in a quantity for sterilization all over the world, it's just so impressive. And it really is a strategic, I'll say, business for Canada and our leadership role worldwide for Canada. And just really glad to be part of that and part of the discussion here today. So again, thanks for joining us today. I wanted to spend some time talking about what we're doing here at Bruce Power in terms of isotopes. As many of you know, we operate the largest nuclear facility in the world, and we generate 30% of Ontario's electricity at 30% less than the average residential cost. We're also running Canada's largest private sector infrastructure program with our life extension program that's investing $13 billion from now through 2033, and that's creating 22,000 direct and indirect jobs, about $4 billion gross domestic product activity in Ontario, and about $8 to $11 billion across Canada. So it's quite a large jobs creator and an economic engine, especially in this COVID time when the economy has just been really hit hard by the lockdowns and the issues that the COVID pandemic has brought into our economy. And we're happy to play that role and be a leader in coming out of that. But we're here to talk about today is one of the, I'll say, the least known facts about our nuclear industry in Canada, and maybe that's because we're all so humble about it, is that Canada really is a global powerhouse when it comes to cobalt-60 production and sterilization. You know, our partners at OPG and Canadian National Labs, so we've been producing cobalt-60 for many years. And with our partner Nordion, we're able to distribute that throughout the world. In fact, the supplies that we make at Bruce Power alone, we're able to sterilize about 40% of the once-use medical equipment worldwide. And then with our partners at OPG, I think Nordion will tell us we are collectively sterilizing about 80% of all the once-use equipment worldwide. But it's quite a notion to sit and think about. And when you put it in numbers, as an example, we did a cobalt harvest on our Unit 6 this year and our Unit 8. And combined, that harvest will sterilize 24 billion pairs of gloves or swabs or nasal swabs in this time frame, or garments, right? It's just a staggering number when you think about our efforts. Slide one, please. So in when I summarize that that aspect, you know, we really are as an industry a collective powerhouse. And I say industry, that's the medical community tied in with the universities and the research sector, tied in with the distributors and our supply chain that can help, that helps us make the pieces and parts that we need to then be able to produce cobalt. Slide two, please. To be able to take further advantage of our position here in Ontario and really look at the types of things that we could do to further the use of isotopes, not only here in Ontario and throughout Canada, but throughout the world, we really started to look broadly at how isotopes are made here at the site and how we can make more isotopes. And in a past session, we talked about a new production system that we're putting into place here in 21 that will enable us to move into the production of lutetium-177 and potentially also molybdenum-99 and then other isotopes, really unlocking our medical community's creative juices in terms of what isotopes could be best made and used for different types of cancer treatments, diagnostics, or sterilization. We're here to talk about sterilization today, but we've taken the necessary steps over this past year to really begin that process. And in July, we've signed a memorandum of understanding with McMaster University to really broadly look at isotopes and how they can be applied within medicine and then even further throughout different types of sterilization practices here in Canada, but also the world. And then to further that study, once it is produced and work hand in hand with it, in August, we launched a Nuclear Innovation Center, Next Generation Nuclear Technology Center with a bunch of our supply chain partners to really start to look and identify the healthcare and economic opportunities that we could experience in Canada by leveraging our new production systems and our abilities to make isotopes here locally and then throughout the province. And I think this brings on many, many opportunities for jobs, both in the healthcare sector, at the universities, in research, as well as in the nuclear industry and distribution industries. Next slide, please. So what really prompted us to really take a good hard look at our isotope production is with the pandemic, it became quite evident that we were going to have to play a large role in helping to combat this. You see, from the early days of the coronavirus that broke out in China, we saw a growing demand worldwide for protective garments. And that high demand meant that if we made them, then we had to sterilize them so that they could be used. On average, other methods of sterilization were taking upwards of 7 to 14 days to sterilize equipment. So you can imagine with the spike in demand, how that would constrain the supply of PPE throughout the world. What we've been able to do with Cobalt-60 is to reduce that 7 to 14 days down to 1 day. So you can imagine now the amount of PPE that can be produced, cleaned, and distributed to meet the needs of our frontline healthcare workers during this epidemic, and all essential service workers, so they have adequate protection during this pandemic. But it also opens up the view that we could use isotopes for many more things to improve efficiencies, as well as to really come to a degree of cleanliness that we need not only in our medical communities, but potentially in our agricultural communities and other industrial applications. And it's with that thinking that we set forward to really explore with the Nuclear Innovation Center and McMaster University what potential projects that we could see. You see, I'm just really proud that we're able to do this as an industry and carry on this great tradition that was started in Canada some years ago. You know, Cobalt-60 in a low specific activity form is used for sterilization, and that's what we're talking about here. But we also make a high specific activity version of Cobalt-60, which powers the gamma knife. And that gamma knife is used to treat brain tumors. It's a non-invasive technology that really enables a patient to have the treatments while still carrying on some normalcy in their life. And we're proud to be able to make these isotopes and be able to do that and to really take a look at how we can expand our efforts in this area to help people. And with that, I'd like to show a video to you really in terms of how we go about harvesting Cobalt-60, how it's processed, and what we use it for here at the plant.
currently we're producing cobalt 60. Cobalt 60 is used to sterilize equipment. It's also used for cancer treatments. It's a really neat targeted therapy when it comes to cancer treatments. So we've been doing that for quite a few years now. But what we're realizing with isotopes is that there's more that we can be doing. Isotopes need some form of irradiation to go from the existing materials to the medical usable form of material, and Bruce Power can supply that irradiation through our nuclear reactors, which is really exciting. It's exciting to see different things that we can be doing with our technology that we have on site, and just opening that up to new opportunities to support not only the electricity world, but also the medical community. So the latest harvest has been really important when it comes to fighting COVID-19. It's been really important when it comes to being able to sterilize equipment that we honestly take for granted. When you think about getting a mask or you think about going in and getting anything in a hospital, you assume that they've done their due diligence in terms of ensuring that all of the pieces of equipment are completely free from any harmful stuff that can be on it. With the latest harvest, we were actually able to sterilize between 20 and 25 billion pieces of equipment. So whether that's gloves, whether that's COVID swabs to do tests, it's really just looking at those volumes that help us to keep everyone safe and to continue to fight COVID-19. The future of isotopes is really just how do we continue to use them? And the flip side of that is also how do we continue to supply them? They do need some form of production mechanism. For us, it's providing that irradiation through our reactors. So Bruce Power is really lucky because we're currently going through a major component replacement program across our facility. And what that means is that our reactors are going to have an extensive life moving out into the mid-2060s. For a medical community standpoint, that means a long-term reliable supply of irradiation, which means a long-term reliable supply when it comes to isotopes.
This is an exciting time for Ontario, as you can see. It's that creativity, that innovation, that drive to do things better that'll carry us well into the future. I think the impact that we'll have as an industry, as a society, in terms of making people's lives better, being able to not only have a healthy outcome from the pandemic, but also to be able to treat and fight against disease. And I just think it's a great time for us to be able to continue our efforts with our life extension program, renewing our reactors to 2064. We have a clear path for many decades to come to be able to produce isotopes in a reliable and stable format and really expand their use throughout the medical community. Thanks for coming this morning. And James, I'll turn it back over to you now.
Mike, and you know, I think that was a really exciting announcement to share. And you know, as you know, Richard Weens, who you'll hear from a little bit later, and our partner at Nordion, you know, none of this would be possible without our work with them. And the numbers that Richard always shares with us are quite staggering. And it's pretty amazing that right here from the province of Ontario, between the Bruce site and Ottawa-based Nordion, you know, we'll have that kind of global impact. So thanks for sharing that, Mike. And it was also great to see that announcement coming from Maya Ingram, who is leading our isotope program at Bruce Power and doing a great job, not only on our cobalt 60 at work, but lutetium and a number of other exciting things. Mike did a really good job explaining sort of how the cobalt 60 role at Bruce Power fits in and what we're doing today and what we're announcing today. What we thought we'd spend a couple of minutes on before we pass it over to our panelists is share a couple of videos and a couple of examples, just to give you a bit of a sense on sort of how do we produce cobalt 60? How is it used? How is it harvested? And how do all of these pieces sort of fit together? And you know, typically when we're not in a pandemic, we're able to have literally thousands and thousands of people visit our site a year through bus tours. And so in the absence of being able to do that and show you ourselves at our facilities and opening up our doors, you know, we've tried our best to develop these kind of virtual tools where we can show people. So what I'd like to do is share with you a short video that has been put together between Bruce Power and Nordion that really takes you through the sterilization process, how it works, and I think it'll provide some additional illustration of what Mike Grenchek shared with everybody. So let's move on to that.
The international community is counting on Bruce Power to keep hospitals safe. We harvest the medical isotope, cobalt-60, from our reactors and ship it to Ottawa-based Nordion for conversion into gamma sterilization products. The efficient gamma irradiation controls infection in many applications. Medical devices, sutures, gloves, syringes, tissue-based products, bone grafts, tendons, ligaments, implants, orthopedics, stents, heart valves, pharmaceuticals, ingredients, fillers, combination devices. As healthcare around the world becomes increasingly sophisticated, the demand for cobalt-60 is growing. With a long-term contract, Bruce Power and Nordion will meet this demand. We share a commitment to our role as a reliable source of life-saving isotopes.
So I think that gives you a bit of further illustration and really built on what Mike talked about. And you know, when we talk about cobalt-60 isotope, there's really three main uses of it that you're all going to hear about today. And obviously sterilization is going to be a key discussion point. But the other area is on treating cancer and very specific types of cancer. And as I mentioned, we have Susan Marshall joining us as our next panelist from the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. And you know, the Brain Tumor Foundation is an organization we've been working with for a number of years. They do just fantastic work on behalf of patients all over Canada. And I really want to really kind of make the link and you know, earlier in this process, Susan introduced us to an individual who we've got to know quite well, Tracy. And Tracy is a patient who was able to access some of this modern technology that is used to treat brain tumors that is powered by cobalt-60. And Tracy, over many years, has been quite keen to share her story with people and raise awareness on this front. So why don't I play a short video from Tracy where she can share her story, and then we'll introduce our first panel of the day.
Started to notice that I was losing my hearing a little bit in my right ear, and I had been to my family doctor, and he kept saying that it was likely just fluid in my inner ear and it would, you know, just dissolve on its own, go away on its own, and just to be patient. I started to have vertigo, off balance, dizziness, stuff like that. The doctor had recommended that we do an MRI. Prior to this, of course, I had been looking on Google and everything else and kept coming up with an acoustic neuroma, which is a rare brain tumor, and all the symptoms had sort of been leading to that, but you know, you're thinking, okay, it's rare, what are the chances? When you hear brain tumor, you think something that's really, really, really serious. To be honest, the thought of surgery scared me, to have my head cut open and not knowing what the outcome would be.
The options are very simple: observation, surgery, or gamma knife radiosurgery. I will tell her that yes, this is one that surgery can be done, but you know, there are risks to the surgery. As a surgeon, I feel that the gamma knife is an option.
It's an arrangement of small sources of radiation called cobalt-60. And because these sources are small and directing pinpoint beams at a target or a location in the brain, we can deliver very precise radiation delivery in the brain with this unit. In our field, we became very worried when we heard that we may not have as good of access of cobalt-60 in the world because people weren't making it, and you know, we depend on it in terms of some of the equipment that we have, in particular the gamma knife. And now that Bruce Power has taken this on, it breathed a sigh of relief, and so do our patients.
This is basically a treatment that uses radiation cobalt-60 supplied by the nuclear industry. So from that perspective, we are grateful to them for supplying these.
I always think that's just a really compelling story. And Tracy, you know, continues to be a really strong advocate for brain tumor patients across Canada and a big supporter of the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. And so with that, I'd like to now introduce our first panel of the morning by welcoming Susan Marshall. She's the president and CEO of the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. And Dr. Sten Myrehaug he's the assistant professor of radiation oncology at the Odette Cancer Center at Sunnybrook Health Sciences Center. I really appreciate him. Earlier this year, Bruce Wallace, the president and CEO of the Nuclear Innovation Institute, we had the opportunity to visit Sunnybrook Hospital. They just do just amazing work on this front. And really appreciate him taking the time to join us. And obviously he's busy with everything from advancing new treatments to helping patients and advocating. And, you know, it's really amazing the work our medical community does on so many of these fronts. But Susan, maybe before I pass it over to you, I do want to share, unfortunately, it's getting cold out here in Ontario and here in Canada, and we all have to get our winter gear ready. And so the hat that I have on here, it's actually a hat that's been provided by the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. It's called Hats for Hope. And so if you want to support the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada, and after you listen to Tracy's story, after you listen to this panel, I guarantee you, you're going to want to support the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. They're currently running their Hats for Hope campaign. And to support the Hats for Hope campaign, you can visit hatsforhope.ca. It's a website that the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada has set up, and mark your calendar for this Saturday. So whether it's warm, whether it's cold, this Saturday, mark your calendar, order your hat, anything you can do on your social media to promote Hats for Hope. It's not only about raising funds for the Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada, but it's also about giving hope to families and individuals who are struggling with a brain tumor, and that they know they have that we have their backs and their support. So again, visit hatsforhopes.ca, wear this on Saturday, put a picture on your social media, tag it. It's really important that we continue to raise awareness. You know, if you look around the world, Susan, I think it's safe to say Canada is a real leader in this space, and we should be proud, like in so many other areas. So Susan, maybe I'll pass it over to you to kick this panel off, and thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much, James, and thank you, Mike, for inviting me to participate in this morning's panel. I'm really proud to be here, and so grateful to Dr. Myrehaug for being with us this morning as well. So as Mike and James have said this morning, cobalt-60 is used in cancer treatments, specifically through Gamma Knife and for brain tumor patients. So I wonder, Dr. Myrehaug, could you please explain for our viewers how this technology works to help patients?
Of course. Thank you, Susan, for giving me the opportunity to speak today. So when we look at the use of radiation therapy for brain tumors, and specifically as we're talking about cobalt-60, we're looking at a treatment that we call stereotactic radiosurgery. Now, what that means is that we're utilizing a radiation source to deliver energy to a target. And the way that this technology works is that we are delivering ultra high doses to a very small specific target over a very short period of time. And we know, based on years of experience, that this treatment can be highly effective for controlling specific tumors. There's different ways of delivering radiosurgery, and one is using the conventional linear accelerators, which are the radiation machines, which would be used for the majority of treatments for cancer. However, the Gamma Knife system is a very specified tool only for intracranial tumors. So really the Gamma Knife system is the dedicated system that we're currently using for treatment of intracranial disease. And the applications are very broad. You know, we will treat predominantly mostly brain metastases with this therapy, but the indication continues to broaden. So as was seen in the video, we will treat acoustic neuromas with this therapy, meningiomas with this therapy, but also as we're gaining more experience with the tool and noting that it can be applied to other disorders, we're actually delving into the field of tremors. We're delving into the field of for some psychiatric disorders where targeting specific areas of the brain can make amazing improvements in people's quality of life. And so it's actually an exciting time to be using this system, because we're able to not only improve what we're currently doing for patients, but really broaden the indication.
Thank you. Could you share with us when this technology is used and not used? Like what type of things do you consider when you're looking at a patient and whether they're suitable for this treatment?
So I think the first factor always with any treatment is we need to make sure that this is the right therapy for the right patient at the right time. And so anybody who is being considered for radiosurgery is discussed as part of a multidisciplinary group. So this would include surgeons, neuro-oncologists, neuroradiologists, and radiation oncologists to make sure that we are applying the appropriate technology to the appropriate person. And really, it's meant to be complementary to all of the other tools that we have for therapy. So first and foremost is it the right person? And then second is it the right indication? And the question would be, why would we use this tool instead of something else? And really, we would be focusing, again, in our practice, primarily on the treatment of brain metastases. That is by far the most common indication that we see. And really, our mantra is, if you can treat with radiosurgery, you should. And I'll speak a bit about that later, but the application of it to the other sites, whether it would be acoustic neuromas, would be in conversation with the neurosurgeons or the ENT surgeons about what is likely to give the patient the best outcome, whether it's looking at control of the tumor, or specifically in that case, because it's in such a challenging location that we want to make sure that we're delivering the therapy that is coming at the least cost in terms of side effects for the patient. And so the decision-making is quite complex from top down, ensuring that we're getting multiple sources of input before we use this technology. One thing that I do want to speak to the audience is this is typically not used for the upfront treatment of primary brain tumors. And these would be diseases such as gliomas, glioblastoma, or low-grade gliomas that we would, as a standard of care, be using a more traditional external beam radiation system rather than the gamma knife. And that's really due to some of the technical details in terms of how the gamma knife razor delivered that is so finely tuned to the target that actually may not be the appropriate therapy for a more diffuse disease such as a glioma.
Thank you very much. You know, advocating for fairness in access to treatments for brain tumor patients is one of our goals at Brain Tumor Foundation of Canada. Dr. Marhek, how are some of the hurdles faced by patients and physicians like yourself in Canada? What are some of the hurdles that you face in accessing gamma knife and radiosurgery technology?
Yeah. So this has been something that we as a group have been grappling with for quite a while, and you're introduced to my colleague, Dr. Sagal, in the video, and he's done a lot of work on a provincial level trying to standardize the approach for patients and improving access to high quality care. And I think it's important to note that the Gamma Knife tool, which is really not the most common way that radiosurgery is delivered, is really only used in high volume centers which have a dedicated neuro-oncology program. And this may not be the appropriate technology for every center, but again, it's important to figure what patient would be appropriate for that and would need travel. Really what we want to do is ensure that patients are getting high-level standard of care treatment as close to home as possible. And this has really been done via outreach with a lot of our community centers to ensure that the systems are up and running and delivering appropriate therapy, to providing advocacy on the provincial level to ensure that funding is being delivered to these centers to improve this access to care, but also then providing a resource to our colleagues across the province that as they set up radiosurgery programs so that patients can be treated closer to home, they're given backup, that they are given some of the benefit of the experience and expertise that the large volume centers have, but also to be given access to our tumor board so that they have the ability to present cases and review them with us and with our neuroradiologists and our neurosurgeons on board, again, so that we can try to minimize travel and inconvenience for patients and ensure that we're delivering high quality care closer to home. And so, you know, the biggest challenge I think that we face is continuing to improve upon these systems and improving that all of the supports are being put into all of the partner centers across the province, and ensuring that we are on our end providing real-time, up-to-date support to ensure that everyone is feeling supported, is feeling that their programs can develop appropriately so that this care can be delivered across the province. Also, Arjun alluded to the fact that we rely on a stable source of cobalt-60 for the Gamma Knife system, because without it, the system would fail. And I remember years ago that there was a nuclear isotope shortage. This was almost 12 years ago. And we had to cut back on bone scans. We had to cut back on MRI scans because there was a global shortage of isotope. And that certainly is a fear that we have moving forward, is ensuring that we've got a stable supply chain to ensure that this technology can continue to be used to its highest potential. And that's one of the benefits of the Bruce Power Initiative, is providing us with that stability so that we know we can move forward.
That is, thank you, Dr. Mierhug. That is so very important, isn't it? That supply chain. When you think to the future, what are your thoughts? Can you maybe share with us what research is being done and how you see this technology helping patients in the future?
Yeah. So one of the big advances that we've seen with the use of the Gamma Knife technology is the development of a system called the ICON. Now, historically, Gamma Knife was treated with patients in an invasive frame, meaning that on the day of treatment, we would have to put screws into patients' skulls in order to hold them still as we were doing the therapy. And you can imagine how that would be from a patient perspective to have that done, but also with respect to flexibility of the system, that it would limit the number of patients that could be treated and also limit the ability of us to move forward with therapy. And so what the Gamma Knife ICON system has done is it has taken away the need to use the invasive frame for many of the procedures. We still use it in certain cases, but rather than rely on that, we can use a mask-based system with advanced imaging so that we can ensure the direct localization of the treatment area, namely the tumors, without relying on these invasive means. And what that has done is that has opened up a whole new world of our ability to use this system and to use it to its highest capacity. Because of limitations of treatment, generally speaking, most patients with brain metastases would have upwards of 1 to 4 brain metastases treated. And that's really historical because of the inability to do more than that because of the technologic limitations. However, ICON opens the door to treating more than just 4. And we know based on very good data that's been done that more comprehensive whole brain treatment, which would have been the standard of care therapy for patients with more than 4, comes at a cost. It's very good at controlling disease, but we know that it may have a significant impact on patient quality of life. And when we're looking at treatment of cancer patients, I think that needs to be one of our utmost concerns, is how do we not only control the disease, but how do we do it in a way that will maintain or improve quality of life. And so with the ability to use the ICON system and to use the Gamma Knife technology to treat in a mask, we can do patients over multiple days. So we can treat 4 one day, 5 the next day, 6 the next. And by using this, we can treat multiple targets. We can treat it safely, we can treat it efficiently. And that has been a practice that we have been developing at Sunnybrook. And we're rolling that out into research. And my colleague, Dr. Eric Seng, has just opened a study where we're trying to understand whether treatment of up to 20 brain metastases with radiosurgery is better than treating with radiosurgery plus the more conventional whole brain radiation therapy. And really the aim of this is moving forward as we look to the broad treatment of patients with brain metastases, should we be utilizing this therapy more, and should we be broadening the indication for more patients? And we've got very good data from the Gamma Knife Society in Japan saying that to treat multiple diseases is safe and that it is effective, but we're trying to understand, does it improve outcome? Does it improve how well patients do with therapy? But more importantly, is it going to improve their quality of life during this really challenging phase of therapy? Additionally, having the ability to do multiple days of treatment in the Gamma Knife Icon mask means that we can increase the size of what we're treating. So we can treat larger tumors, or we can treat more complex tumors which are in critical locations. And so really I see that having the coupling of advanced imaging technology as well as the ultra-precise targeting that the Gamma Knife system can do is really going to lead the way for research in terms of how we apply this therapy across the globe. And I think it's going to make a truly global impact.
Wonderful. That's wonderful news for brain tumor patients across Canada and over all over the world. So thank you so much for that hope. Thank you so much for helping us understand the role that Cobalt 60 plays in treating brain tumors and about how radiosurgery technology is truly changing lives. Making treatments more accessible for patients in Canada has its challenges, and yet you seem very hopeful, which is wonderful. Is there one message that you would like to leave with our viewers today, and what would that be?
I think the message that I want to leave the viewers is we continue to get better, that this is an area of passion for all of the members of the neuro-oncology field in terms of how can we make life better for these patients which are dealing with very scary disease? And how can we continue to improve not only the experience? I think that has been a big move from moving from the frame to the mask, was making what can be a really frightening experience better. But also know that we are actively working to use this technology to do the proper research so that we can not only make this an in-house treatment where this is our belief and this is what we're able to do, but really we want to give the hope that we're trying to translate this approach and translate this research into real and tangible benefits for patients, not only at the big Gamma Knife centers, but really across Ontario, across Canada, and eventually globally.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mirahag, for being here today. We really appreciate you sharing your knowledge and expertise. And thank you for bringing hope to our community today. Back to you, James.
Great. Thank you very much. That was just a great discussion. And, you know, when you listen to these kind of discussions and you see the video from Tracy, it really reminds us that, you know, sometimes we can get very focused on, you know, the various operational focus areas, the various challenges, all the things we have to do day to day to make these isotopes. But the real reminder is that I think that people are counting on us to get this right. And it's not just our fellow Ontarians that are counting on us to get this right, but there's a lot of people around the world that count on this capability. And I know you referred to, you know, periods of time and years gone by where there was a shortage of isotopes, and ultimately a shortage of isotopes impacts the use of the isotopes. You know, I always like to frame isotopes when a lot of people say, well, what is an isotope? You know, a company like Bruce Power, you're generating electricity. You know, electricity is used to power our homes, business, schools, and hospitals. An isotope is used to power modern healthcare. And that's really how I like to frame it. So I really appreciate you taking the time, and, you know, collectively we'll continue to work to make sure that supply is there through 2064 and beyond, so you can keep doing the great work. So thank you for both of you for joining us today, and keep up the great work.
Thank you.
And remember, visit hatsforhope.ca, and let's do everything we can to raise awareness about brain tumors and the work of the Brain Tumor Foundation this Saturday. So visit hatsforhope.ca. It's a beautiful winter roots toque to begin with, and you also are supporting a great cause. And so thank you for your support on there. I'd now like to shift the discussion a little bit. And our next panelist is Cynthia Scott Dupree from the University of Guelph. And this is a really exciting discussion that, you know, I'm really looking forward to having, because often when we've talked about isotopes historically, we tend to focus on cancer treatments, we tend to focus on sterilization, and those are absolutely critical. But the work underway at the University of Guelph really goes to show you the broader uses of cobalt 60 and challenging and tackling some of our most significant health challenges around the world. And, you know, the world today remains very seized with COVID-19, you know, it wasn't too long ago that you know, when you traveled throughout the world, that the big concern in some areas of the world was the Zika virus. And, you know, we can't pretend that the Zika virus has disappeared. And things, activities, research, development that were carried out all over the world, the Zika virus. And so, you know, Professor Scott Dupree is the chair of the Crop Science Division at the University of Guelph. And I'd like to welcome her to the discussion today. And there's a split screen working. So thank you very much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me speak. And just to clarify, I'm a professor in the School of Environmental Sciences and a former chair, Bear Crop Science Chair in Sustainable Pest Management, because there is a Department of Crop Science and I'm not the chair of that.
Okay, so, sorry, I apologize, I had that wrong. But you know what, you're all things Zika is what we're... So we really do appreciate you you joining us. And I think really the key issue for us here is, you know, it's pretty amazing in our own backyard of the University of Guelph. I'm a University of Guelph graduate. It's, you know, known for its work in particular in agriculture and in business and a whole range of areas. And, you know, I think University of Guelph is one of the closest universities to the Bruce site, in fact. So it's just great to have you with us. So maybe you can start today. Maybe just talk to us a little bit about the work that you've been leading generically, maybe before we talk about Cobalt 60, just so folks have an understanding of some of that work that you've been leading and to really frame the challenge that you've been trying to tackle.
Okay, I do have a set of slides that will probably allow us to focus on some of those concerns. Okay, just a sec, I'll go back. Okay, so I'm going to speak to you in my presentation about the use of cobalt 60 for agricultural applications. But in the bigger sense, the use of sterile insect technique can be used in a medical application, because there are situations where it's been used on insects that vector human diseases. And James mentioned Zika virus. So I'll touch on that briefly, but I'm focusing primarily on how it can be used in agricultural situations. So first of all, I work in the field of sustainable pest management or integrated pest management, and I'm sure most of you will not have an understanding of what that is. But what we work on is a careful consideration of control techniques for specific insect pests. And we look at the integration of those appropriate measures in an effort to discourage the development of these pest populations and keep pesticide use at a low level. We're very focused on ensuring that the techniques that we use are economically justified and will reduce or minimize the risk to human health and the environment. as opposed to the copious use of chemicals that could have a long-term and negative impact on humans and the environment. We want to avoid that, but integrated pest management does still utilize chemicals as one of the control tactics, but we just want to use it with caution. So that gives you an idea. So we're looking at the use of multiple tactics, genetic controls, which is what sterile insect technique, cultural controls, biological controls, chemical controls, all pulled together in a refined program that focuses on decreasing pest population in a particular agroecosystem. Now, where does sterile insect technique come from? It's not a new technique, but it's certainly seen a revolution, if you will, in terms of its increased use in pest management programs these days. In 1927, a researcher in the US, Muller, was looking at exposing fruit flies to X-rays in an effort to sterilize them. So he was focusing on things like mutagenesis. And as a result of his work in this area, he won the Nobel Prize for discovering sterile insect technique in 1946. Shortly after this, two researchers for the U.S. Department of Agriculture, Kipling and Bushland, were working on a very serious problem with the New World screw worm, Cochleomyia hominivorax, and it causes miasis in livestock and in humans. And so this was a major problem in the southern U.S. where they have huge herds of cattle which were being plagued by the screw worm. So they adopted the use of sterile insect technique to mitigate this pest problem. And they dropped they managed to decrease the pest density very, very quickly, and ultimately by 1984 had totally eradicated screw worm from the U.S. That is one advantage of sterile insect technique, is potential eradication. In IPM overall, we are not focused on eradicating insect pests in any particular field. We look at dropping pest pressure to below an economic threshold, so below a point where they're causing any economic loss to the crop. But there are certain situations with sterile insect technique where eradication can occur. Now, in terms of how the application of sterile insect technique would work in medical applications, there are a lot of mosquito-borne diseases that will infect humans. The genus of mosquito known as Aedes is the mosquito that will vector Zika, dengue, chikungunya, and yellow fever. And these are all human vectored diseases that impact humans globally and are very, very problematic. Another species of mosquito known as Anopheles is the one responsible for vectoring malaria. And all of you will probably know the impact of malaria globally. So there is potential in a lot of research that's being coordinated by IAEA, FAO, and WHO on utilization of sterile insect technique programs to control these mosquito-borne diseases. I'm not working on those specifically, so I'm not going to focus on those today. But what is sterile insect technique? Well, basically, it's looking at the genetic modification of insects to reduce their reproductive capacity. So in simplified terms, it's birth control for insects. So in the beginning, they looked at sterilization using chemicals, so chemosterilization. But now most of the interest is with gamma radiation, which is what we're focusing on today. So the point of the sterile insect technique is to introduce sterility into wild insect populations, pest populations, and focus on the rapid reduction of their numbers to below this economic threshold. But as I mentioned, sometimes eradication can occur, especially if you're geographically isolated. There are many examples of screw worm eradication globally where they introduced it on islands, except for example, or in confined valleys. My particular research that I'm working on now is focused on an invasive greenhouse pest. So because greenhouses are confined areas, there is a potential that we may be able to eradicate this pest from these operations. Whoops, sorry about that, folks. We focus primarily on sterilization of males. And there's two reasons for doing this in an agricultural setting. First of all, male insects typically do not damage the crop. And secondly, sterility is more easily introduced widely and rapidly using sterile males, because we are effectively sterilizing millions of sperm. So that would increase the rapidity of this spread of sterility versus sterilizing females who produce a lot fewer eggs. And so that's why we focus on male sterility. One of the critical aspects of a sterile technique, sterile insect technique program, though, is that we have to figure out a way to separate males from females before the sterilization process, because we want the program to be efficacious and we don't really want to be releasing any potential females into crop situations. The potential for success of sterile insect technique in agricultural situations is based on a number of factors. First of all, we have to investigate the biology of the insect. We have to understand their sexual reproduction process. What are their behaviors? The most important thing that we need to focus on in sterile insect technique programs is that we want to induce sterility, but we do not want to impact sexual behavior. These sterile males still need to be able to fly, they need to be able to find females, and they need to be able to successfully mate with wild females in order to pass on the sterile sperm. And therefore, the doses of gamma radiation that we expose them to cannot have an impact on this kind of behavior, only on the sterility. So that makes it a little bit more challenging when we're doing the research. The insect pests we use have to cause direct damage. That's typically better. Direct damage means they're causing damage to the harvestable part of the fruit. I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about pepper weevil, and pepper weevil causes damage right to the pepper fruit. So that's what direct damage is. We have to develop a way of mass rearing these sterile insects, or mass rearing insects, so that we can sterilize them, because the releases of these insects, we're not just releasing 10 or 15, we could be releasing 10 to 15,000 individuals into a particular confined space. As I mentioned, we have to separate males from females. We have to develop ways of easily transporting and dispersing the sterile males to the sites that need their attention, and develop particular release programs in the areas where the pest problem is situated. And in past programs with tsetse fly and other insects, they have been released aerially, dropped from great heights to fields. So there's lots of very innovative ways that we can disperse. We don't have to go out and disperse them by hand. These programs tend to be more effective if they're area-wide, so not just one farmer using them, but all of them in a particular area. And then the most important thing of us all is that this sterile insect technique is extremely compatible with all the other IPM tactics that we may be using in an overall IPM program. Cultural controls, biological controls, chemical controls, physical controls, they can all be combined with sterile insect technique. They're compatible, and that's extremely important. The process really involves radiation of the life stage of the insect that you want to be working with. We'll probably be working with the pupal stage. The result of this is germ cell damage, breakage of double-stranded chromosomes. So in the bottom of this slide, you'll see the male symbol with the radiation symbol around it. So those are the sterile males are released to seek out the wild females and to mate with them. And the result will be non-viable or unviable eggs. So the population of pests will diminish fairly rapidly. The insect pest that I'm working with is known as the pepper weevil, Anthonymus eugenii. It's a typical weevil with a very long snout. I don't know if any of you have seen them, but you can pick out weevils very, very easy because of this long nose, if you will. They were first detected in Canada in 92, but really not considered problematic, but their population continued to increase. They were found in the Leamington area in 2009, still not causing major problems. I mentioned the Leamington area because this is a major greenhouse production area where lots of peppers are grown. The value of the greenhouse pepper crop in Ontario is worth $280 million annually. In 2016, this pepper weevil raised its ugly head and inflicted $80 million worth of damage on the pepper crop in Ontario. It hasn't been as problematic since then, but the growers remained extremely concerned about it because it can increase very quickly if they're not managed properly. So you can see in the bottom right-hand corner the type of damage that occurs in the pepper. The females lay eggs on the outside of the pepper. The eggs emerge and the larvae crawl inside the fruit. And the complete life cycle of the insect occurs protected inside the fruit. So the fruit may not look damaged on the outside, but I'm sure that if you bought a pepper and cut it open on your counter and found that damage in the middle, you wouldn't be too happy. So it is extremely problematic. The things that we're doing on our particular project here, and we're so thankful for the collaboration and funding provided by Bruce Energy and Nordion on this particular project. I'm also working collaboratively with Dr. Rose LeBay from Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada in Harrow. They have a huge greenhouse facility there. And we now are able to fund a master's student, Jacob Basso, who started doing this work. So what we're looking specifically is the dosimetry. What dose of radiation is required to effectively sterilize pupal step pepper weevil without impacting their reproductive fitness? So these are the studies that Jacob has now initiated. He's primarily working at the London Research Station or at the Harrow Research Station right at this moment, because they are able to produce the high numbers of pepper weevil we need for these particular studies. The process when we get it sorted will involve sterilization of pupa, as you can see in number one, then the transportation of those sterile pupa to greenhouses or initially to our lab to see what works. Then the mass release of the pupa into the greenhouse in numbers that we know will inundate the wild population. And then what happens is that we, as I mentioned, will inundate the population in four there with sterile males. They'll outnumber the fertile ones. They'll outcompete the fertile males for mating with the females. The result between these crosses between sterile males and fertile females will be non-viable eggs. This will effectively drop the pepper weevil population, and the result ultimately will be no damage to the peppers. So we hope we can save millions of dollars to the growers on an annual basis. Is it sustainable? It certainly is sustainable in terms of the fact is that we have no pesticides identified that will work for this pepper weevil, and that's primarily because they are using the protection of the fruit to develop in. Nothing we could spray could get inside that fruit, and we wouldn't want it in there anywhere because there could be potential problems with residues for consumers. We can use this sterile insect technique to supplement other IPM tactics that can be used in an overall increased efficient pest management program for pepper weevil. And we know that there's no adverse effects on beneficial insects that are used in biological control programs in these agricultural situations. And of course, sterile males do not emit any kind of radiation, so we don't have to worry about that. Efficacy increases. Efficacy of the sterile insect technique increases with every release of sterile insects. So there is very much a chance that we'll have to release sterile insects several times in the greenhouse before we can drop the population below an economic threshold level. But that is not unusual and not a major hurdle. This type of sterile insect technique does not result in the insect pest becoming resistant to sterile insect technique. Continued exposure to chemicals can with time result in resistance to those chemicals, but that does not occur with sterile insect technique. Again, the primary major hurdle for us is to produce enough insects to sterilize so we can release these high numbers that need to be done. But we remain optimistic about that as well. And that's the end of my talk. I hope that introduced a different aspect of using cobalt 60 for sterilization purposes. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Cynthia. That was fantastic. And I think, one of the other things that in terms of the community that we operate in is, we tend to think of energy and Bruce Power and the nuclear industry as a major economic driver, but we're also in a very heavy agricultural region. Here in southwestern Ontario, Canada is a significant agricultural country. And what I'm really excited about listening to the important work that you and your colleagues are leading at the University of Guelph is I think this is going to be an area of continued investment that we need to focus on, because I think coming out of the COVID-19 pandemic, a lot of these human health risks and the associated elements that we have to tie in with our agricultural operations and communities across the world, I think are going to be absolutely important. So thank you very much for your time, and please pass our thanks
to
your colleagues at the University of Guelph.
Thank you. Thank you, James.
Thanks very much, Cynthia. And our next presenter is Richard Weens, who's the Director of Strategic Supply for Nordion. And many of you have heard from Richard before. Richard and his organization, they are absolutely critical partners of Bruce Power. And Richard, maybe I'll pass it over to you to really take people through what you're seeing more broadly in the sterilization market around the world, and in particular, how COVID-19 is changing that.
Sure. Thanks, James. First of all, I wanted to say thank you to James and Mike and the whole Bruce Power team for providing me the opportunity to speak to everybody today. Let me start, I think, with a little bit of history. So we should have the first slide up there, I think. Is the slide up? There we go. Perfect. So cobalt has been making a contribution to the health and well-being of people around the world for a long, long time. And it's kind of a unique story in that Canada is a pioneer in a couple of these spaces. So on the left-hand side there, you'll see the first cobalt therapy, teletherapy machine that was used for the first cancer treatment using cobalt 60 in 1951 at Victoria Hospital in London. This was really the precursor to the gamma knife that we've already heard about. So whereas a gamma knife is a couple hundred individual sources, this was a single 10,000 curie source. So that's one of the pioneering moments. The other one is on the right-hand side there, which is the world's first large-scale gamma processing plant that Nordion actually built for Johnson & Johnson in 1964 in Somerville, New Jersey. So cobalt's been around for a long, long time. Nordion actually has its roots even longer ago than that. We tend to point to 1946 as the start of our company. So we've already covered the patient treatment aspect of cobalt 60. It's clearly continues to be an important aspect of our business, but I was going to focus on gamma processing. And gamma processing really is around the reduction of pathogens and other microorganisms using gamma energy that comes from cobalt 60. So you can see there's a list of products here. And then there's some other sort of adjunct applications. So we've heard about sterile insect technique. There's a very related application, which is phytosanitary treatment, but all of the products that you see on this list here, the whole point of gamma processing is basically to get rid of microorganisms on the products themselves. And the primary application here is the use of gamma processing for sterilization of single-use medical devices. So this is probably 80% of what cobalt is used for around the world. And you know, we talk about the billions of devices that are sterilized. The US FDA estimates that about 16 billion devices annually in the US are sterilized using cobalt 60. So that's a lot of devices. And these are things like drapes and gowns and syringes and tubing and orthopedic implants. You can see a picture of that there. You know, a huge variety of devices. So we've seen a little bit of the cobalt production process in the earlier videos in terms of the harvesting, but I wanted to just take a minute and share with you the process in a bit more detail. We start with cobalt 59, which is a naturally occurring element, and we sinter that into slugs, basically cylinders that are about a quarter of an inch long and a quarter of an inch in diameter and an inch long. And we take those and we put them into tubes made of a special alloy called zircaloy, and we arrange those tubes. That's the top middle picture there. We arrange those tubes in some assemblies, and we string them all together in what I like to think of as kind of a shish kebab, which becomes an adjuster assembly, and that goes into a nuclear reactor. So in this case, it would be the Bruce Power or the OPG reactors. And those white lines you can see on the right-hand picture represent those adjusters. And they stay in the reactor for an operating cycle. So a typical CANDU operating cycle is somewhere between 18 and 36 months, depending on which reactor it is. And during that operating cycle, the cobalt 59 picks up neutrons from the nuclear reaction that's happening primarily to generate power. And the cobalt 59 becomes cobalt 60, which is the source of gamma energy. And after the operating cycle is done and the reactor shut down for a maintenance outage, some very skilled people at the reactor site remove those cobalt 60 adjusters and they place them in their spent fuel bay. And that's the picture you can see on the bottom left hand side there is actually a discharge of cobalt from a Bruce reactor. There are 24 of those adjusters. And those same people basically disassemble those adjusters back down to the bundle level, and they place them in a special shipping container, and they send that to Nordion. So what happens when it gets to Nordion? So on the left-hand side there, you can see one of our cell technicians, Angel is his name actually, and he's using something called a telemanipulator or a manip. He's standing in front of a hot cell, which is basically a room with really thick concrete walls. So think of a meter thick concrete. The window he's looking through is 42 inches of leaded glass panes with some oil in between to help with the distortion. And basically whatever he does with that manipulator that he's got in his right hand there is mimicked on the inside of the cell by the manipulator you can see in the top right hand corner. So when the cobalt comes to us, we take that container, we put it in a pool, we take the cobalt elements out, we put them in the hot cell, we cut them open, then take out those slugs I talked about, and then we take the slugs and we put them in another tube, and that's, you can see that kind of happening on the right hand side there. We weld the ends on that tube, we put that tube in another tube, and you end up with the final finished product, which is what you're seeing on the bottom right hand corner there. And that's a thing called the double encapsulated sealed source. Our product name is actually C188. It's about 18 inches long and a half an inch in diameter. And again, it's got that double encapsulation. So so what happens after that? So we ship this to customers around the world. There are roughly 250 of those customers around the world in 40 countries, roughly. And we take those C188 sources, we put them in a cage. You can see that on the top left there. That goes into a very specialized shipping container, which weighs about 12,000 pounds. We put a plug on the top, put some fire shielding on it, and we ship it to customers that are around the world. So one of the things I wanted to point out here was that almost the entire supply chain that I've just shown you in the last three slides is based in Canada. So the targets and the adjusters are made by Bruce Power and OPG, of course, do the irradiation at the reactors. We do the manufacturing of the finished sources. The containers that are used for transportation are made by a company called Best Medical, which is just down the road from us here in Ottawa. There are companies that specialize in radioactive materials transportation, Jade and Cassidy, both located in Ottawa. So really, this is a made in Canada success story. So what happens to the product after it gets sent out? So there are about 250 of these large scale irradiation facilities around the world. Nordion happened to build about 125 of them. That's another part of our business. And just for perspective, this facility here, or the cutaway of this facility here, would be about 50 feet wide and 150 feet long. So very large scale facility. So when the product gets to the facility, we put the container in another pool, which is a theme here. We take those C-188 sources out, we place them in a source rack, which is kind of the blue glowing picture you see on the bottom there, and that source rack is part of the irradiation facility. When it's not in use, it's parked in a pool of water. It's about 25 feet deep for shielding, but when it is in use, which is most of the time, it's actually pulled up into the irradiation cell. So again, big thick shielding, concrete shielding to prevent radiation from getting out. And what happens is the product is placed in metal tote boxes. You can see those little gray boxes with the yellow tops. Operators will place the finished product, so this would be syringes or drapes or gloves or gowns, place those in those boxes. They're circulated around the radiation source, and that's where they pick up the dose of radiation for sterilization. And then the irradiated product is moved out of the irradiator and back into and shipped off to the ultimate user, which in this case is typically hospitals or other clinical settings. So what makes gamma and cobalt 60 so important during COVID-19? I guess the one thing I would say is that cobalt 60 really is like nuclear power is base load for energy production. Cobalt 60 is base load for providing healthcare, for providing safe medical products. But it does have some special features that make it really important during COVID-19. The first of which is that it's a global solution. I talked about those 250 facilities around the world. So virtually anywhere you go, there's the ability to sterilize product with cobalt 60. Very reliable technology. The irradiator I showed you is pretty standard material handling equipment. It's got some sophisticated controls and safety in there, but it's fairly straightforward process. You're only worried about how much time the product spends in front of the source. That's the only parameter, really. So very, very high reliability and uptime. These facilities run 24/7 in most cases, so very dependable. Back to my first slide around the history of the technology. The technology has been around for a long, long time, and it's very well understood. So there's established global standards for how to validate and operate. And what this means is that you can introduce new products quickly. So you can see on the right-hand side, I've got one of the pictures is of nasopharyngeal swabs, which became a hot commodity in the pandemic, and lots of new manufacturers using technologies like 3D printing have produced new products, but they have to be sterile, and the sterilization process has to be validated. And you can validate a new product for a gamma sterilization using cobalt 60 in weeks versus months, or in some cases years, for other modalities. So it means that new products can get to market very, very quickly. Somebody, I think Mike mentioned earlier on how fast the process is. So you can turn around a whole truckload of product in a day at a typical facility. And then it's highly flexible. So one of the things that we noticed during the pandemic is that kind of the mix of products has changed. So a lot of the medical devices that would normally be used for elective procedures, for instance, that volume tailed off because those procedures got canceled or postponed. But of course, the volume of things like swabs and PPE and anything related to treating COVID-19 patients actually went up. And one of the beauties of Gamma and Cobalt 60 is that it's very flexible and you can accommodate those kind of sudden shifts in product mix. So I hope I've given you a little bit of a flavor for how important Cobalt 60 is to providing global healthcare. I mean, it really is a significant and meaningful export. 95% of the cobalt that gets produced in the province of Ontario is exported to global markets. It's very prevalent. One in two devices anywhere in the world that you would find in a clinical setting is sterilized with Cobalt 60. The demand for Cobalt 60 continues to grow, and we continue, as James pointed out, to look for new sources of cobalt supply. Ontario really is a pioneer, and Canada is a pioneer. It's a globally recognized leader in this space. And beyond the value of the export at home, the contribution really is high quality jobs throughout the supply chain. So at Nordion alone, there are 150 employees who are dedicated to this all day, every day. I would say that I'm really enthusiastic and optimistic about the future of cobalt and the province of Ontario, given the amount of energy that's putting into reactor refurbishment. So I think that cobalt will have a long and successful career. That's it.
Well, thanks very much, Richard. I think that's a great presentation and a great overview. And please pass our thanks on to you, Kevin Brooks, all the folks at Nordion. You know, often we tend to put a lot of focus on where the cobalt is produced and harvested, but you know, we have to remember, and I think you reminded us, there's a whole ecosystem right up to Ottawa that powers this. And so this is just a great export story for Canada. And I think you're spot on. You know, Bruce Power is committed to continue working with Nordion to find ways of increasing our cobalt production. I know we've announced, we're looking at that together. I know you're doing some great work with Ontario Power Generation around Darlington, which is just fantastic because those units are also going to run another several decades. And so thank you very much for your time today.
Thanks, James.
So now I want to go to our final guest of the morning, Michael Barrett, who's the president and CEO of the South Bruce Gray Regional Health Center. And really want to welcome Michael. And really, Michael, the reason why we wanted to welcome you today is, not first and foremost, want to thank you and all of your staff in the region for all the work that you're doing for our communities, for our employees, for pensioners of Bruce Power, both at your COVID assessment centers and your facilities. I know it's been a long 7 months for our healthcare system. And first and foremost, I want to start by thanking you for your leadership. And just to kind of, and maybe to kick things off, Michael, and maybe I can kind of pass it over to you. You've heard a lot of the dialogue today, and really the way we wanted to wrap today's session up was, you know, you as somebody who is, you know, I really look at the end user. You have patients that with your employees that you have to treat. You have requirements. Maybe you can talk about, as president and CEO of the hospital, really, you know, when you hear all of this about sterilization, just really explaining to people the importance of personal protective equipment and really what that means in terms of safe healthcare in today's world.
Great. Thanks very much, James. And I think you've framed it nicely that at for South Bruce Gray, I can almost complete the cycle here in the conversation, in that we are the ones that are using that sterilized equipment when it comes to us. And Richard made a very valid point that during the first wave of COVID, we canceled surgeries, we reduced the number of our procedures. So that portion of the our responsibilities went down, but then we are also doing obviously a significant amount of testing. We run an assessment center in Kincardine. We need the production of the Cobalt 60 materials and all the work that the other partners here are doing today. Maybe just a bit of background for the audience, and I realize we're running short on time here, so I'll just be quick. We're a four-site hospital. One of our sites is in Kincardine, which is in the backyard of Bruce Power. And you think Bruce Power, with being a large player on the international stage, that they would almost look over top of the surrounding community. And I can tell you it's anything but that. Bruce Power has been a tremendous support to the local communities, tremendous support to us at the local hospital. And a big thank you to Mike and to James for all their support that they've shown us over the during this very challenging time over the last 7 months. Our staff and physicians know the importance of isotopes, not only to us here in our own hospital, but to us, but to the Canadian market and the international market. Some of the support that we've received from Bruce Power over the last number of years is we obviously provide the acute and emergency care for Bruce Power, its employees, its contractors, and the communities that surround Bruce Power. We operate an assessment center, a COVID assessment center, as I said. We also work together with Bruce Power on a contaminated casualty program. So we have in our emergency department, we have a contaminated casualty treatment room, which we work hand in hand with Bruce Power to ensure that we are able to respond effectively and safely. As James said, safety is a key tenet in all this conversation to make sure that that happens. So tremendous support from Bruce Power on that aspect. And then also from Bruce Power's perspective, they've been tremendous with us during the COVID response. We've received tremendous response from all kinds of community partners, businesses with PPE, snacks and meals for our staff. But Bruce Power has really gone above and beyond in providing. They donated over 2,000 N95 masks to us very early in the COVID response, when those N95 masks were very difficult to come by. And then over the following weeks and months, Bruce Power also provided face shields, gloves, hand sanitizer, and actually provided restaurant gift cards for a large number of our staff, which was really appreciated, because our staff were, as you can imagine, it was a pretty tense time during COVID. And that was just a nice recognition of the work that our staff have been doing over this last 7 months. So big thank you to Bruce Power. The last piece I'll say, James, is that Bruce Power has also been instrumental in helping us get a CT into our Kincardine site, which is, as I said, in the backyard of Bruce Power, and donated $1 million to ensure we can have a CT scanner in our Kincardine site. So very pleased with the support. And hopefully we see it as symbiotic, that we support Bruce Power, its employees, its contractors. Mm-hmm. And Bruce Power in turn supports us to make sure that they've got a strong hospital system to support their needs. So again, thanks very much for holding this session. Very interesting to me in terms of all the applications for the isotope, and happy to continue to be a part of the medical isotope panel.
No, Michael, thank you very much for that. And certainly we'll pass that on to the team. Continuing to support our local regional healthcare is a priority also for our CEO, and he sets that tone at the top and allows us to do a lot of the great things that we do. The final thing, I think it was really great that you're able to help us wrap today's session up, because at the end of the day, Michael, it's all about what happens at your sites, right? It's the first place patients go in an emergency. It's where anybody who meets the requirements for having symptoms and need to go to a COVID assessment center, and all of the things we're talking about. We talk about big numbers of billions of swabs. Richard talked about and Mike talked about. At the end of the day, it's all about making sure that a frontline nurse doing a swab has a mask, has gloves, that swab is clean. And so, if we're not getting it right in our own backyard, it's tough to make a difference beyond that. So please pass your thanks on to all the staff. I know we're a little bit short on time, Michael, but also appreciate you. You bring a lot of other experience in many of your previous roles, working with the Local Health Integration Network and across healthcare in Ontario. And so we really appreciate you being a member of the advisory panel as well. We'll look to wrap things up there. I know we have a hard stop at 10:30, but just before I wrap things up, just a couple of items I wanted to conclude today's session on. The first is, I want to thank all of the panelists for taking the time out of their busy schedules to be here. This medical isotope advisory panel is also about Bruce Power learning. It's about, what are the things we can do to leverage the asset that Mike Renchak talked about to continue to do good, and we continue to do good together, but there's always more to do. I also want to thank Maggie, Mike Dawson, and Jeff, who are working behind the scenes to pull all of this together. They've just done a fantastic job as usual, and everything has gone off without a hitch. And you know, despite the fact we have many people online watching this will also be available on our website. We've been the team has been live tweeting throughout today's presentation, and you know, this is a really important message to get out, because we're only able to do these things that all of these experts are talking about with public policy support. And so, you know, we're at a fortunate place here in Ontario and Canada where we do have a lot of public policy support for this entire value chain, and getting the message out and educating is a key component of that. So I want to thank everybody for joining us today, and wish you a safe and productive day.